I see the windows in the church.
Good morning, everyone. I have it's 9:30, is that right? Yeah, so we can get started. Super.
Can we bring the seventh grade class in this?
Yes. Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, totally.
You had no choice.
So I have a summary from last time, if anyone would like it, or if they weren't here for last time. It's mostly a lot of bullet points without a lot of explanation, but it'll give you kind of the overview of what we talked about.
Thank you.
Anybody?
Do you want me to get some from him?
We'll see.
You can make more pre-sessions.
Okay. Yeah. This is just from last time. Do we want to do that, maybe? Yeah, make more copies?
Yeah, we'll give more.
Did you guys want any? No?
I can share. I'll share.
We're not talking about it this time so much. It's just, we are going to do a little quick review, but... okay. Well, should I wait for the seventh graders then? Oh, there's actually some more people coming here. Hello, good morning. Welcome. I have, in case anyone would want one, I've got a summary from last week, if anyone's interested. And then also maybe we can pass out some of these Bibles. Maybe Maya is going to help some. Maybe we could...
Thank you. Oh, I don't want that. I have this Bible right here.
Anyone else? Over here. Here we go. Yep. Oh, you have one? Great. Okay, anyone else? All right. Actually, I'll stick a few. Okay, well, welcome. And glad that you're all here this morning. And if you're joining us for the first time, we started last week, and we have one more session next week. And so Mark, as you know, is a short gospel. It's one of the shortest. So we'll spend just a little time reviewing some of the highlights and summaries from last week before delving into this week's session. But before we begin, I invited us last time to sort of put on our Lenten lenses, because we are pilgrims going through Lent right now. And so it's no small thing that we're studying Mark right now as a lectionary as well. And if you were in worship this morning, you would have heard Pastor Tim's sermon, which actually is a passage that we're going to cover today about taking up our cross. So it's the timing couldn't be better, really. So we were kind of delighted that dovetailed together like that. So I put this picture up last time as well. This is actually a walking path in Ireland that was right by our house that we'd walk every day. And I do miss it. And it was a beautiful way to have sort of a contemplative, prayerful time going up on this little pathway. And I think today, as we begin, I'm thinking of this word. Sometimes we have words that really grab us. And one word that's really grabbing me right now is the word luminosity. I don't know why. I just love saying that, luminosity. And luminosity is the amount of brightness that a light gives off in relation to what the human eye can observe, how we can see, how much we can see by. So as we'll see as we go, the Gospel of Mark, we've broken up into three parts. So last week we had the first part, and we've been illumined a little bit by this. We're going to be illumined hopefully a little more today in week two. And Elizabeth Barrett Browning, who is a poet, had this in one of her poems called Audrey Lee. The earth is crammed with heaven, and every common bush afire with God. But only he who sees takes off his shoes. The rest sit around it and pluck blackberries. So the earth is crammed with heaven, and every common bush afire with God. But only he who sees takes off his shoes. So that's reminiscent of what Moses did, right, on the holy mountain, the reverence, taking off, knowing it was holy ground. And so what she's saying is it's all holy ground. But only those who have eyes to see will see that. And that really is what this second section of Mark is about today. So as we put on our own Lenten lenses, as we go through our own pilgrimages this Lent, today, maybe look through that lens of seeing. How am I seeing? What do I need to be looking at in my own life? What am I not seeing? What's blinding me from the things that God wants me to be seeing? And you'll find that this text then is going to become very rich because it's all about that. It's all about blindness and being able to see. And that luminosity factor becoming brighter and brighter and brighter. Okay, so just to review, for those who weren't here last time, and then for those who were, just a quick, we're just going to do a quick kind of run through. So I have a friend who's a sister of mercy. I knew her in Ireland. We were in a course together. Sister Mary Kay, and Mary Kay was a Markan scholar, and she taught at Vanderbilt. And when I found out I was going to be doing this, I said, Mary Kay, how would you break down the Gospel of Mark if you had like 3 weeks? And she said, oh, that's easy, Amanda. And so this is what she recommended, and so that's what I went with. And if you think of the Gospel of Mark being a sort of drama, it breaks down into three parts. So Act 1 was Jesus and his public ministry. That's what we studied last time. Act 2 is the journey on the way, and that's what we're going to be talking about today, the journey on the way. And then Act 3, Jesus and his passion, death, and resurrection. So the timing is perfect with us in Lent as we're heading towards Holy Week and Easter. And next time we'll be talking about that. But today we're talking about the journey on the way. And I'm going to come back to that in a minute. But just a quick review on Mark. And this is just a bit of a summary from last week. And I do have, if you want, here's a summary sheet. And it's got all the extra bits. We're not going to go through everything, but it'll give you a little taste of Mark. So who was Mark? Well, he's believed to be John Mark, who we read about in Acts. He was a cousin of Barnabas, the son of Mary of Jerusalem. Now, Mary of Jerusalem, supposedly, she was the house where all of the disciples met in Jerusalem. And they believe, actually, tradition has it, that it's the place of the Last Supper as well. So John Mark, it would have been his house where, presumably, where they had the Last Supper. He also, this is a very important piece about Mark. The accounts you're reading are not firsthand accounts. They would have been, the Gospel of Mark would have been a secondhand account. And he was a companion to Peter. And Peter, we don't know if Peter couldn't write. There's debate on that. Some feel like for sure he should have been literate, but they're not sure. But in any case, Mark was his companion, and he wanted him to write things down. And so Mark wrote everything down. So the Gospel of Mark is really through the eyes of Peter. It's all about Peter's account of what happened in Jesus' ministry. Also, Mark originally is from Egypt, and that's where he died, in Alexandria. He's the founder of the Coptic Church, which is the oldest church, Christian church. The symbol for Mark is the winged lion. We talked about that last time. All the gospel writers are attributed a different thing, a symbol. Luke is an ox, and Matthew is a man, and John is an eagle. And that comes from a passage in Ezekiel that talks about evangelists, and it gives those markings. And so that was drawn out for the New Testament, and they kind of pull that thread through. And so if you go to churches and you ever see a winged lion, that's symbolic of Mark. Now, if you ever go to Venice, you'll also see in the big square there, there's, you know, the lions at the top of one of the things. You'll see it all over the cathedral there. And when we visited, I was so excited because I knew we were going to be seeing where his remains were. We're going to go to the cathedral there. And only to learn that actually he originally died in Alexandria. It's where he was martyred. He was dragged through the streets, a horrible death. He was buried there, but in the 800s, his remains were gathered up and taken to Venice. So it wasn't actually, he didn't actually end up in Venice, you know, originally, but that's where he eventually found his way. And that's where people have it. And as a result, he is the patron saint of Venice. So anyway, a few other things to maybe know about him. You've got all this in front of you here. But one thing that's important to know is they believe that it was written for a Christian audience, a Roman Christian audience. They believe this was written in Rome, and this was written to Christians, unlike Matthew, which was written for Jews. So that's why you see in Matthew, how does he start off? the whole account of the genealogy, right? And you have the birth narratives, all these things, because they're trying to tie Jesus back to the line of David. This was not so important for the Roman Christians, right? So this was to a different audience. You also know this by the way it was written. You can find in passages where he'll use expressions that are Aramaic that Jesus would have used, like Talitha Kum for the girl that he rose from the dead. And then he goes on to explain it, which is extraordinary because what we find in Mark's gospel is it's super fast. And he doesn't give a lot of details, but he takes the time to explain some of these Aramaic expressions, which again makes sense if he was writing to a Roman Christian audience. But maybe the biggest thing to realize is that there was persecution going on. So Nero, the guy up there on the left, was the emperor at the time. Of course, you've heard of the all the things going on in the Colosseum where Christians were thrown to the lions. They were horrible. We talked about some of the things last week that were done to the Christians at that time. So this would have been people that were probably very afraid. They were being persecuted. The reason for that was that Nero at the time found them to be a very easy scapegoat. Rome burned in 64 AD, and rumor got out that actually Nero started it because he wanted to burn everything down and create new things. So in a way to deflect that rumor from himself, he decided to blame the Christians. And they were an easy target because they did not worship the same gods, they didn't partake of the same pagan festivals. So they were kind of seen as, you know, kind of weird, kind of different. Who are these people exactly? So they became an easy scapegoat. And that's when a lot of the persecutions began. And they continue all the way to the 300s until the Edict of Milan in 313 or something like that, where there was a religious tolerance edict that was made. And then, of course, after that, Constantine took over and actually Christianity became the state religion. So just a few characteristics in him. And you can see for those who have the summary. But one of the main things is Jesus really comes off as a superhero in this one, and we really saw this last week in those first bits. The miracles, the healings, all this stuff. And he goes quickly. So it's a very brief, short. If you read it, it doesn't take long. You'll see he jumps from here to here to here to here. And it's like, wow, this is kind of amazing. You also see that Mark's gospel really emphasizes what Jesus does over what Jesus says. So the other synoptics, Matthew and Luke, you know, that's where we get the Sermon on the Mount. There's a lot more of the teachings of Jesus. But Mark is very action-packed. It's about his miracles, his healings, da-da-da-da-da, all that sort of thing. So at the beginning of the first part, in Act 1, we see all this stuff happening. What we also see is that Mark has this great gift for storytelling. He's a wonderful storyteller. And so we see that in words like immediately this happened, immediately that happened. There's this sense that he keeps you entertained as you're, and then guess what happened? And you're barely hanging on, like, wow, really? But he doesn't let you hang on. He's like, no, but then guess what else? You know, and so you're just like, whoa, you know, it's a real interesting page turner. And it gets you kind of excited that Jesus must be amazing. But the other thing we get in Mark is some of the most human pictures of Jesus. And we'll see this next week a lot more too. But we'll see Jesus getting angry. You know, we'll see emotions showing a lot of compassion, things that the other Gospels don't maybe pick up on quite as much as Mark does. Now part of that, and this is another theme, you're going to see Jesus call himself the Son of Man everywhere. And very rarely you'll hear Son of God brought up, but it's brought up as well. So those two things. And that really talks about Jesus' dual nature, fully human, fully divine. And Mark really keeps pulling those threads through as well. One other thing that really you see a lot in Mark is this secrecy, this messianic secret, as they call it. But he'll go and he'll heal someone, but he'll say, shh, don't tell anybody. And then he'll go and he'll do this amazing thing and, you know, shh, don't tell anyone. And so you're kind of reading this like, what? Why can't people tell? Now, some people do go on and tell. But that becomes a real question. Why does Mark make a point to say that? What's he teeing up? What's his point? And the real point of that is that the idea is that all of this is moving toward the last week of Holy Week. So next week, it's going to be all, his whole gospel is pushing towards that. In fact, some commentators have said Mark is a gospel about the story of the Passion, Death, and Resurrection with a really long introduction. So it's all leading up to this. And he doesn't want you to think too quickly about who Jesus is, because you won't fully understand that and you won't have that full luminosity. We won't be able to light that third candle until the very end. And up before that, you're not going to get it. And that's kind of where he's going with this messianic secret thing. So, anyway, basic themes that Jesus has all this power. You'll see this. The things that do see who Jesus' true identity is are the demons. The demons that Jesus cast out. We looked at this last week. All the demons knew when he cast them out. You're the Son of God. He's like, oh yeah, I am. Right? They saw it. None of the people saw it, but the demons saw it. But anyway, he had power over that. He had power over illness. He had power over death. He even had power over creation. Like we have the story of the stilling of the sea. Okay? Also, Jesus had the authority to forgive. That was huge because only God had the authority to forgive. And so this starts in motion, and this is where, again, it's all leading to this last week of his life, where even chapter 3, verse 6, we start to see the plotting to kill him, because the Pharisees and the scribes are saying, wait a second, he's saying that he can forgive? Only God forgives. Who is this guy? Who does he think he is? And so you see this plotting starting really early on in Mark's gospel. So those are some of the things of summary. One thing you find, I just wanted to mention these are good just to remember. In chapter 2, you have a bunch of conflict stories, and those are on the sheet. We won't take time to go through those. But an example would be, how about fasting? And who objects? The people that were around were objecting because they noticed, hey, your disciples aren't fasting. Go back and look at Jesus' responses to these. All of these five conflicts, you either have the Pharisees or the scribes. People were getting upset that Jesus was doing something. And why were they upset? It tells, you know, that shows why they were upset. And then go back and look at what Jesus' response are. But these are the things that are starting to get the plot against Jesus. And it's interesting that Mark uses this kind of literary style where he groups them all in chapter 2. In chapter 4, he lists all of his parables, and there's only four parables. So you can remember four parables are mentioned in Mark, and they're all in chapter 4. And essentially what we find and what Mark is really saying is that some are going to follow Jesus, some are going to reject him, and some aren't sure about him at all. And where he explains this is in the parable of the sower, because that's one of the parables that he actually not only talks about it, but then he goes back with the disciples later and explains to them what that meant. Some are going to hear it, but aren't going to do anything about it, you know, and that sort of thing. We talked about the messianic secrecy. Another thing about that I wanted to mention, and I think it was Rowan Williams had talked about this in his book. I won't take time to read the passage about it, but essentially at that time, it was not strange to have charismatic healers going around. That was sort of flavor of the day. You had people going around giving healing. So another idea is that Jesus didn't want to be known as just another healer. So that could have been another reason for him trying to kind of, tell people, no, because they would just go, oh, we've got this guy, he's a great healer. Well, Jesus was so much more than that, right? But people weren't getting it, and he didn't want them to think he was just another charismatic healer. One last thing before we launch into the main focus for today is on the feeding of the 4,000. We're really familiar with the feeding of the 5,000. In Mark, we have the feeding of the 5,000, and then a few chapters later, we have the feeding of the 4,000. But in there, we didn't talk about this last week. This comes right before what we're about to launch into. And it's the warning of the yeast of the Pharisees and Herod. And I just want to take a minute with that because that one is kind of interesting. Let's see. It was N.T. Wright. Let's see here. So it says, the Jews used leaven to make ordinary bread, but at Passover time they were forbidden it to remind them of when they were in a hurry to leave their slavery in Egypt, and they only had time to make unleavened bread. Now Jesus speaks of the leaven, or the yeast, not to warn the disciples about the wrong sort of bread, but to put them on guard against the wrong sort of kingdom vision. The Pharisees are diluting the vision. They want God to set up a kingdom for the benefit of Jews who can observe the law with great strictness. and not for the benefit of a wider company that Jesus is hanging out with. So Jesus' kingdom vision is very different. And his extraordinary feedings are signs of what is about, of what it is about, and assurances to the disciples that this is really happening. So remember last week we talked about, again, my friend Sister Mary Kay, she talked about the spirituality of scarcity and the spirituality of abundance. So in the feeding of the 5,000 and 4,000, we see the spiritual of abundance. And the disciples were afraid. We don't have enough bread. We don't have enough. How are we going to do this? And Jesus showed them another way, that there's going to be enough. There's going to be enough in my kingdom for everybody. So what this yeast, beware of the yeast of the Pharisees and Herod. Their kingdom, their vision of a kingdom was very different. It was only for certain people. And Jesus is breaking it open and saying, beware of that kind of yeast. That's not the kind I'm talking about. And if you look at the parables, those four parables that he chose, they're all about little seeds and they're growing. You know, the mustard seed. It's going to start out really small, but it's going to be big. It's expansive. It's for everybody. And so that's really a key as we now head into this week. So the journey on the way. I did want to point out that what's really cool about this, you'll see throughout the text, the journey on the way, you're going to see that term, and they were on the way. And there they went, on the way. You'll see that throughout Mark. And so what's really cool about that is that this term, the way, was the early Christian word for what we today would call Christianity. So it always has a double meaning also. They were literally on the way. So Jesus' ministry was all up around Galilee. Now they're heading and they're making their way down to Jerusalem. I don't know if you can see these very well, but Jerusalem is right here. Okay, this one. And so they're going to start making their way down. So what we have is today, these are the towns we're going to be going to. We're going to start up in Bethsaida, which is up towards the top right, just below Caesarea Philippi. So we're going to start there. We're going to go to Caesarea Philippi. Right above Caesarea, you're going to see a mountain that's circled. That's Mount Hermon, where we believe the transfiguration took place. The other place that some people think it is Mount Tabor, which is down here. But if you, do you see, I don't know if you can see by my shadow right there, this is Mount Tabor. And you can see if they were in Caesarea Philippi, that would have been a really long way to go down there for the transfiguration. So the prevailing belief is it was at Mount Hermon, which is just north of Caesarea Philippi. So they go up there to that mountain, then they go down to Capernaum, make their way down to an area of Judea. These did not have actual, in the scripture you'll say they just went to Judea close to the Jordan, so there's not a descript village, but kind of the countryside, and then eventually down to Jericho. And then that's the place they are right before they head into Jerusalem. And that's where we'll pick up next week when they enter into Jerusalem. So just to look at some of the structure of this passage. Now, can I have everybody go on and open up to Mark chapter 8? Does anybody need a Bible? Or you can share with folks? Does anybody need one? Are we all good? Okay. Oh. Rachel? Okay, so let's look at chapter 8. And we finished off, I just kind of told you about the yeast of the Pharisees and all that. That was in 21. Now we're starting in verse 22. Jesus cures a blind man at Bethsaida. Now we're going to look into that further, but I just want you to look at this structure, which is really interesting. And this is what got me so excited about Mark. So Mark, who seems so on the surface, this is just brief, this is, you know, whatever, this is not any details, and you're kind of like, come on, there's got to be more. Wow, there's so much more in Mark. He had a big plan. In fact, I was reading, we talked about this last time, I really love the Gospel of John because I love all the imagery and I love the depth of the theology and all that. And somehow Mark always just seems to come off a little bit like, eh, you know, it's just running here, and telling people to be quiet, and what is this? Well, this is where it gets really exciting because he is very methodical in the way he's going about things and the way he's presenting the story. And I read somewhere that of the Synoptic Gospels that he is actually much more like John in that regard because he's really he's really got a lot of meaty things he's trying to, messages he's trying to get across to his audience. So here's the cool thing. It's, I called it a bookend structure, but it's actually been called, remember the Markin sandwich we talked about last time? The story within the story? So someone called this a sophisticated sandwich. So he's getting very sophisticated now. But essentially, we have the healing of the blind man at Bethsaida, and then we have the healing of blind Bartimaeus at the end of this section on the way, before he enters Jerusalem. So why did he put a blind story healing in the front and a blind healing story at the tail end? He bookend this whole section in the middle on the way with the healing of the blind man. Interesting. The first fellow, we don't know his name, and actually we're going to hear about how that blind story works out. But interesting, the last guy gets a name. Most of the people Jesus healed don't have a name. You know, the Syrophoenician woman, they just are kind of the nondescript person. But this guy gets a name, Bartimaeus, the last guy. And we're going to talk more about his story and what that means for the Gospel of Mark. Well, anyway, sandwiched in between that, Mark is getting to the heart of what this is about. This whole section of Journey on the Way is around the question, who is Jesus? Who is this guy? We just saw him, you know, in chapters 1 through 8 to 21, doing all these amazing things. Is he just another charismatic healer? Is he really the kingly Messiah that we're looking for? He's going to come and take Rome down and we'll be back, you know. Is that what he is? What is he? They're all wondering. And even the disciples, and that's another big theme, they're not getting it. They're not getting it. And Jesus keeps coming back and saying, don't you understand? Well, I guess we don't understand. And they keep, you know, keeps that whole tennis match keeps going back and forth. Well, now in the middle, Mark is saying, we've got the healing of a blind man. And then there's going to be these three sections. So there's only three chapters we're covering today, from 8:22, chapter 9, and chapter 10. In chapter 8, we see what was the gospel lesson for today, where you have him asking, who do you say that I am, to Peter and the disciples. And Peter says, you're the Messiah. Although Peter had a different idea of what that was, but we'll get to that. And then in chapter 9, again, he talks about a foreshadowing, and all three times, he talks about a foretelling of his death and resurrection. So let's turn to chapter 8, and let's look at verse 31. So he tells this before. Could someone read verse 31 and 32?
Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him.
Okay, so Peter was kind of upset when he heard this, because he was totally with him on the first part, you know, that, you know, he has a sense of who he is. He's like, wait, you're what? You're going to die? Wait, you're going to suffer? You're going to die? What? Like, it's almost like he couldn't get to the next part, which is even seems even crazier. Wait, you're going to do all that, and then you're going to, after 3 days, rise again? What does that even mean? What are you saying? This is craziness. So he's not understanding this, right? He's not getting it. He's not understanding. So he rebukes him, and this is where we have this really striking passage. But turning and looking at the disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things. Okay, that's really powerful. So Jesus is saying, I have a mission. You don't fully understand. I know what kind of Messiah you think you want, but that's not the kind that God has brought. That's not what this is. And somehow, in this journey on the way, Jesus is trying to bring the disciples along to get them to understand who he is and what this is all about. Okay? So, we see in 9, let's turn over to 9. Actually, you don't even have to turn. I think it's just on that page. It's so short. 9:30. Can someone read 9:30 to 32?
They went on from there and passed through Galilee. He did not want anyone to know it, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him. And 3 days after being killed, he will rise again. But they did not understand what he was saying and were afraid to ask him.
So can't you just imagine that? And I love that bit, how he said they were afraid to ask him. You know, if you're ever with someone and they're going on about something and you're like, what? And you're kind of like, what are you talking about? What? And there's kind of this sense of, and then an even heightened fear that, what do you mean he's going to die? I mean, they were really getting stuck on that too. You know, you're going to die? What? That's not how this is supposed to work, right? So they're still not getting it. And then let's look further.
Sorry to interrupt you, but maybe they remember what he said to Peter last time.
That's what I was thinking.
Yeah, right, exactly. Don't call me Satan. He's going to rebuke. If we say anything, he's going to get all mad at us. So, like, oh, okay. Absolutely. Okay, look at chapter 10, verse 32 through 34. Anyone want to read that for us? 32 through 34.
They were on the road going up to Jerusalem, and Jesus was walking ahead of them. They were amazed, and those who followed were afraid. He took the 12 aside again and began to tell them what was going to happen to him, saying, See, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be handed over to the chief priests and the scribes, and they will condemn him to death. Then they will hand him over to the Gentiles. They will mock him and spit upon him and flog him and kill him. And after 3 days, he will rise again.
Okay. So there we have it. We have three times, and it's no coincidence, it's three, right? There's a whole theme with the three days, risen 3 days later, you know, all those kind of things. But there's three times. What's more striking, because it's Peter's kind of story, how many times did Peter deny Jesus, right? Three times. And then also we see in John's gospel, actually, where John is, you know, or where Jesus asks Peter, do you love me? And he asked him this three times. And all three times, Peter says yes. So in some ways, it's almost like a nice reconciliation on the denials that had happened before. But anyway, we see this theme of three. Three times this is told, and then we get the healing of Bartimaeus, the blind can see. So let's go into these stories just a bit more. So let's turn to 8:22. This is where the journey and the way technically starts. The blind man at Bethsaida. And would someone read 22 through 26 for us? Anyone?
Sure.
Okay.
They came to Bethsaida. Some people brought a blind man to him and begged him to touch him. He took the blind man by the hand and led him out of the village. And when he had put saliva on his eyes and laid his hands on him, he asked him, Can you see anything? And the man looked up and said, I can see people, but they look like trees walking. Then Jesus laid his hands on his eyes again, and he looked intently, and his sight was restored, and he saw everything clearly. Then he sent him away to his home, saying, Do not even go into the village.
Okay, interesting. So what's interesting about this story of healing? What did you notice?
Well, it didn't happen entirely.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It didn't work the first time. Now it's interesting, this is unique to Mark's gospel. And some commentators felt that Luke and Matthew maybe were kind of embarrassed that it didn't work. That wasn't the kind of Jesus they wanted to portray, that somehow he did it but it didn't work and they had to go back and work, he had to do it again. And so that's one of the readings you can take from it. It's like, well, so could Jesus not heal him? Like, what's going on? Well, Mark has a different idea about this. So what, any ideas on what that might be? Why would Jesus have to go back and help him see? Any thoughts, given the context of what we know about what Mark is kind of doing?
That he was human also.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, maybe it's like on the first round he kind of physically healed him, so his eyes worked. But on this, when he laid his hands on him, he kind of helped him to have a sense of faith that he could clearly see. So it's maybe physical and then spiritual.
Yeah, interesting. And notice that he also took him out away from the people. It says he took him out of the town. So he was, this wasn't, you get the sense it wasn't around the people around, right? And then he, what does he say at the end? He says, don't even go back home. Some of the translations are, don't tell anybody. So it's that same kind of idea. It's the flavor of, don't talk about this, right? So what about that? I mean, this is the thing that makes Mark so like, what? Well, in the context of this sandwich that I was just showing you, the blind story flanked at the beginning and the end, the bookends, right, has something to do with that. So I'm going to share this part right here. Given the story's position in the plan of Mark's gospel, the healing of the blind man at Bethsaida looks back to the disciples' blindness and looks forward to the gradual opening of their eyes. So you see how the disciples were blind. Jesus is working with them. They're trying to see a little bit like the blind man. Oh, I can see the trees walking. I'm not quite there. And Jesus accompanies him and still stays with him and keeps working at it till he finally sees. So Mark's story of the gradual healing of the blind man plays a pivotal role in the structure of this gospel. The blindness of the disciples is not an affliction beyond healing, but healing will not be effected all at once. Their journey towards understanding will not be completed immediately. Further effort will be needed by Jesus to open their eyes. In the meantime, they will see partially, but what they manage to see will never match the fullness of clarity. That will only happen when Jesus' mission is completed. Only when Jesus' destiny is fulfilled on the cross will his true identity be revealed. And then it will not be one of the Jewish disciples who will be the first to see, but a Gentile. So the Roman centurion, and we'll talk about this next time, he's the one person beside all the demons that said, surely this was the Son of God. Surely this was the Son of God. So it's kind of interesting, isn't it, to think about how thoughtful Mark was in constructing this gospel, that Mark was really trying to get a point across that they couldn't fully see, and Jesus was going to keep working with them, but they couldn't fully see until the very end. It won't come to its fruition until the very end. And so that's kind of what that's about. So now we're going to go up to Caesarea Philippi. Now, this is interesting. Caesarea Philippi, there's a picture of what it probably would have looked like. It's where the god Pan is believed to, that's where they built a sanctuary for him. It's at the hill base kind of Mount Hermon. It's where that whole mountain range starts. And there's a big cave there, and there was a big spring. So some of the water for the Jordan River originates from this part. And here's like some ruins from today, kind of what it looks like. But that would have been kind of what it looked like, excuse me, at that time. So this is the scene, and this is what we had in our gospel today. This is the scene that is the turning point of Mark's gospel. So this is where the question of who do you say I am happens. And, excuse me. So why don't we look at that? Do I have that written down here? Let's take a look at chapter 8, verse 27. Okay, can someone read verse 27 through 30?
Jesus and his disciples went down to the village around Caesarea Philippi. On the way, he asked them, "Who do people say I am?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" And Peter answered, "You are the Messiah." Jesus, that's it.
Yeah, no, that's good. But yeah, go ahead. And?
Jesus warned them not to tell anyone about it.
Right. Interesting. Okay, so here we have where Jesus, just like in the sermon today, Pastor Tim was talking about it, he gets it, but yet he doesn't get it too, because there's still this idea of what the kingly Messiah would be doing. And the disciples still weren't getting it. They still weren't getting that this is different than you think. And this is what takes us into this next bit. Because following Jesus is not like being a friend with the king who's in charge and it's all, you know, fun champagne and roses or something, right? It's a different kind of life. And that's what he starts to talk about. And this was in our gospel today, which is, take up your cross and follow me. Let's look at that passage. Verse 8, 34 through 38. And would someone be able to read that for us?
He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it. And those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels."
Okay, thank you. So this is a passage we know quite well, right? We've heard about that. And just to put on our Lenten lenses for a minute, I just wanted to share, when we think about whatever crosses we all bear, and life can unfold in so many ways for us personally, we all have, crosses take a lot of different shapes, don't they? A lot of different manifestations in our life. And we've all been touched by sadness in some way. Whether it's in losses of loved ones or illness or you name it. There's so much hurting and things going on. And I wanted to share with you a friend of ours from Ireland. Her name is Biddy McLaughlin. And she just came out with a cookbook. And this is Biddy right here. This is her little cottage in the village that we are from. She has a little white cottage. It has a little red half door on it. And Biddy's known for her oat cakes. She perfected an oat cake, 200-year-old recipe that was her great-grandmother's, And this is her little son, Johnny, who she is a foster child for her. And there he's enjoying some of her oat cakes. And I was thinking, next time I'll have to make some of these oat cakes, and next time you can try one. They're quite good. She puts ginger in them, and they're really lovely. Well, the thing about Biddy, and you look at Biddy, and she just exudes joy. And here's Biddy right here with her, the ones laughing here. That's Biddy. Just a bright light. I mean, you see Biddy and you just feel like she's family. She will hug you immediately. She has a warmth. All our visitors that came, when they met Biddy, they all said, that was our favorite part of the trip, was meeting Biddy. And, but here's what's interesting about Biddy. Biddy's husband drowned in the bay right in front of her house. Biddy's sister was murdered by her sister's husband. Biddy's brother-in-law is now in jail. Biddy has had cancer twice, has lived through that. Biddy has had a life, a hard life. She turned to art at one point, and she's a folk artist, so it's kind of cartoony. And this is just a little piece I had. I was there one day. She was just messing around. She had this old piece of tin. And I said, oh, what a lovely angel. She said, oh, here, Amanda, it's yours. And I'm like, okay. But Biddy is just a bright soul. One time, Biddy was being interviewed and about her life and the hardness of her life. And Biddy said, well, every now and again, I take my cross. And I set it down, and I put some flowers on it, and I continue on, because it's the only way I can continue. She put some flowers on it, and then she keeps going. So what does this say, this way of the cross, this journey we're on, that we're to carry our cross, and it's not going to be easy, But there are flowers on the way, and what are those flowers? And what does that say about community? What does that say about the people that love us? What does that say about our relationship with Christ in our life? Who can point us to some of those flowers along the way? And so it's something to think about in our Lenten journey. So after that whole thing, where he's trying to explain to them, hey, this is the big time, guys. This is not like a tea party. You know, this is a lot that's going to be happening. I need you to understand this. They're not getting it. Well, then you think this should be enough. And you would think this would be the high point of journey on the way, the transfiguration, where they go up in the mountain, and there they see Jesus in all his glory. Let's just look. Can someone just read that passage 2-8? Anybody?
Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud came a voice. This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him.
Okay, where's the part about his clothes? Could you read that part again? His clothes.
The part about what?
His clothes. Oh, sorry. The verse, chapter 2-8.
I got it.
Oh, sorry.
6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them. And his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them.
Okay, just pause right there. Isn't that funny? Like, so for Mark, who, like, doesn't give a lot of details, could you just read that sentence again on about his clothes?
Yeah. And he was transfigured before them. His clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them.
It was so white that no bleach on earth could be that white. I chuckled when I read that. I thought that was really something. Okay, so obviously this is quite a dazzling affair, okay?
And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice. This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him. Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus.
Okay. So you'd think that this would be, like, pretty pivotal. Like, if they didn't get it before, they would totally get it now, right? You get this sense that they should probably get it. Well, it says, although Mark places the transfiguration at the center of the gospel, he is careful not to claim too much on behalf of the disciples. There is no recognition of Jesus' identity by his followers. Whatever happened on the mountain, and however the story is interpreted, Mark's theological scheme remains secure. No one will recognize Jesus' identity as the Son of God until his destiny is fulfilled on the cross. So, thus, in the larger context of the gospel, it is the death, resurrection, and resurrection, not the transfiguration, that will reveal who Jesus is to his followers. For the disciple of any age in history, Christ can only be understood in the light of the cross. So, even with all this, that wasn't enough. We need the full story. There is a great part here that talks about that, and I'm trying to remember. I don't seem to have written it down. I think it was in here, maybe. Let me see. yeah, this is from Rowan Williams. He was the Archbishop of Canterbury in England, Anglican priest and theologian. He said, Mark is saying, because, you know, I think the thing is, we can be a bit dumbfounded with our perspective now, and we're like, why weren't they seeing this? They saw him do all this stuff. They were at the, you know, they saw the transfiguration. I mean, can you imagine if we could have seen that? But we have the benefit of the whole story, right? We've lived through the other side. We've seen the whole fruition of this thing. But here's what Roe Williams says. If you're finding this difficult or shocking, Mark is saying, if you're finding this difficult or shocking, don't be surprised. Those who are closest to Jesus found it difficult and shocking too. If you feel stupid at a loss when confronted with the words and work of Jesus, don't be surprised. You're not the first, and you won't be the last. He wants you to focus on the person of Jesus and on the relation that you might have with him, knowing that only so does the radical change come about. You could almost say that Mark prefers to show us a Jesus who is struggling for words rather than a Jesus who is a fluent teacher and brilliant storyteller like in the other Gospels. We always hear him saying, "How can I make this clear to you? Don't you understand yet?" This is a Jesus who is searching for ways to communicate truths for which there are no clear and simple words. So it makes some sense that this is a gospel full of secrets, silences, and misunderstandings, a gospel on which every page carries a very strongly worded health warning to the reader. Don't think you have it yet. You don't. You don't have the whole story. So that's kind of an interesting thing that Mark's bringing to us here. So I'm going to just share this one real quickly. I thought this is interesting. Immediately after that, as they're coming down the mountain and whatnot, they come across this story of a boy who has a spirit in him. It's like he's got maybe epilepsy or something because he's foaming at the mouth, and you know, if you read the account there. And but here's what's interesting. The dad comes up and he said, "Jesus, you know, can you heal? Because your disciples tried and they couldn't heal him." Now, if you remember back last week, we talked about where Jesus gave them the authority to heal the apostles. And so they were going out and doing healings in Jesus' name. Well, here, the guy said, they tried, they couldn't do it, right? So it really becomes a story of belief. And I don't know if you've ever, this is a favorite verse for a lot of people, but Jesus says, all things can be done for those who believe. All of this comes back to an issue of faith, comes back to an issue of faith. And the father cries out, "I believe, help my unbelief." And isn't that our prayer? Help my unbelief. I believe, but help my unbelief. Because I have a lot of unbelief, too. And Jesus, let's look at that passage, actually. And let's see what Jesus' response to that is. Sorry. It's on chapter 9. It's a really long passage there. So, okay, so, I believe, help my unbelief. When Jesus saw that a crowd came running together, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to it, "You spirit that keeps this boy from speaking and hearing, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again." So he comes out, but then they said, it looks like he's dead. He's just laying there, right? But then Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up. He was able to stand. So this was a little bit of a tip-off to what's about to come in the resurrection, right? This bringing up, this lifting up, right? He's lifting him up. And then what's interesting is that then, this is the fun bit at the end, then the disciples were like looking at this whole thing unfold, and they're like, well, why couldn't we heal him? And what is Jesus' response? Can someone read Jesus' response? It's at verse 29 there, 9:29.
He said to them, "This kind can come out only through prayer."
I just thought it was kind of funny. Well, this kind of spirit can only come out through prayer. And that has a whole nother richness to it. There's Gillian of Norwich. She was a theologian and mystic from the 14th century in England. And she had a saying, "Prayer fastens the soul to God." Prayer fastens the soul to God. So think about, Jesus just came down from the Mount of the Transfiguration. I mean, he's pretty filled at this point. That was pretty big. And he was on holy ground. He was in a holy space. He was, and so the idea is that when we are doing these prayers and intercessions and all that, we need to be people of prayer. You know, we need to be coming from that deep communion space with God, this deep, deep abiding. And so we get a flavor of that. So it's kind of funny. Here's the gospel. You don't find this anywhere else, you know, where you have, like, the healing of the blind man that doesn't take the first time, does it again. You get the disciples saying, "Well, we tried. We couldn't get it." And Jesus says, "Well, this one takes some more prayer," right? So you're seeing a real kind of a I think, a very authentic expression of life, really, where things don't always just go like, do-do-do, right? And Mark's really taking us there, which is great. Okay, so then we find ourselves in Capernaum, and this is kind of crazy, because then we get into all these random sayings. It's kind of like Mark was, like, doing really good. He had all this, like, really great structure and, like, all these amazing things, and it's like he had all these bits, and he's like, well, I gotta get these bits in, too. So we see kind of a lot of random bits. I say random. They actually all have very important pieces that we need to take with us, nuggets to take with us. But these are the nuggets that he brought out. And we won't have time to go through all of these things. But I thought it was interesting in verse 42 and 50, he's talking about salt. And, you know, we hear that story in the other Gospels about being, you know, the most famous one, of course, being salt and light, be salt of the earth. And they flesh that out a little better. This is kind of a different account, and we don't have time to go into all the details. But I love his last little bit that Jesus says about that. Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another. So one thing that's happening is Jesus is showing two pieces of our spirituality, right? That we're tending to ourselves, right? But then we also, then that spills out into our community with each other. Who are we being called to be as people on the way? You know, we're to be prayerful people. We're to be people abiding within God and within God's love. But we're also to extend that out, right? Just like the feeding of the 4,000 and the 5,000 and this spirituality of abundance. This is for everybody, that we're to be at peace with one another. In chapter 10, he gets on the section of divorce. What's really interesting is the reason that Moses had the law that you could do that, Jesus takes us right back to the center core of that message. Why? He said, because of your hardness of heart, Moses did this. Your hearts were hardened. And in that text, Jesus is trying to go back to what's God's best purpose for us in relationship? It's that we're together. It's that we're together. That's God's best plan. So he's trying to bring everybody back to, let's not always have concessions and aim low. Let's go for what God really intends. Let's shoot for the best possible thing. That's what God wants for us. You know, relationship, wholeness, all those things. Then we have the verse on little children come to me, which we all know. Again, expanding, and that spirituality of abundance, and it's open for everyone. Children were some of the most insignificant people, right? They don't hold jobs. They're just, you know, and they were sort of dismissed. And Jesus, gathering up, said, nope, bring them all to me. They're all a part of this too. So he's really broadening at every turn for us to think more expansively, to us to get back to the heart of God's message, and to open our arms really wide. So then we keep going down. Let's see. Then the rich man, verse 10, 17 through 31, the rich young ruler. This guy is a faithful guy. He comes, I've done all these things, you know, but what do I need to do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus says, you have. You've done so many great, but you lack one thing. And do you remember what that was? What does he tell the rich young ruler? Sell all you have, right? That whole thing. Give it all up, right? And follow me. Get your cross and follow me. This is the one example of a story where we see all these stories where Jesus says, follow me, and they follow him. This is where that doesn't happen. He's really sad because he has a lot of stuff, and that's too big of a call. And he walks away. But the interesting thing is that, and this is one thing I just want to highlight, Mark's gospel is the only one that does this. The other two that shares the story, Matthew and Luke, they don't say this. Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said this. In some translations say, had compassion on him. So everything keeps going back to this idea of love, compassion, getting people to, Jesus is speaking out of a place of love. So even though this message is hard of carrying the cross, Jesus is saying it, speaking the truth in love. He's coming from it from a place of love. And that's an important thing to consider. So then finally, we get to Jericho, and this is the last stop before Jerusalem, which we'll enter in next week. And interestingly, we have the healing of the story of Bartimaeus. Bartimaeus gets named. He's one of the few people that get healed that gets named. And let's look at the healing of Bartimaeus. It's on chapter 10, verse 46, and it goes down to 52. Can someone just read that for us?
And they came to Jericho, and he said, and his disciples and a large crowd were leaving Jericho. Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus, a blind beggar, was sitting by the roadside. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout out and say, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." Many sternly ordered him to be quiet, but he cried out even more loudly, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stood still and said, "Call him here." And they called the blind man, saying to him, "Take heart, get up, he is calling you." So throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. And Jesus said to him, "What do you want me to do for you?" The blind man said to him, "My teacher, let me see again." Jesus said to him, "Go, your faith has made you well." Immediately he regained his sight and followed him on the way.
Wow. So here you have this guy. Now this was a one-shot deal. He was immediately healed, his sight was restored. But he immediately jumped up, his cloak fell off, and he went. He joined. Immediately he followed. And I just want to show you this interesting contrast, and we won't take time to go and read this back. Twice Jesus asked this question, "What do you want me to do for you?" So there was a request, a chapter just before that, and James and John came to him, and they asked him, "Hey, when you become king," because remember, they still don't have it. They know he's Messiah, but they think he's a certain kind of Messiah. And they're asking, "Hey, grant us to sit one at your right hand and one at your left in your glory." I mean, they're like, "Hey, our dude's going to be like, you know, the king. I want to be up there with them and, you know, share in some of that glory," right? That question was asked. What do you want? Jesus says, "What do you want to do for you?" That's what they request. Jesus asks this question again of Bartimaeus. "What do you want me to do for you?" And what does Bartimaeus says? He gets it. "Teacher, let me see again." And that, of course, has double meaning, right? Obviously, he wants to see. But think about it. The answer, "My teacher, let me see again." And that's what this whole section in Mark is about, seeing. Immediately, he regained his sight. And what did he do? He followed Jesus on the way. And it's the same Lenten path we're on. We're on the way. So let's pray. Gracious God, illumine our hearts that we might see. In Jesus' name, amen.
Like your enthusiasm.
Okay. Well, it's interesting. It's kind of tough gospel, but when we start realizing all the cool stuff he was doing, it's like, oh, you know.
But you know, you really have to take somebody that studied other books and that really know what's happening.
You do.
I've read that, yeah, can you say, "Well, God can do anything. Why didn't he heal him all at once?" And it doesn't come past him. The answer doesn't come unless you study.
Right. Right.
I mean, I would have been illuminated had it not been for you.
Well, so. No, but the other thing is, there are volumes for this, right? So it's just like in the literature, the graph.